Welcome you to our evening service. Many of you have already been to our other service and meeting, and welcome to the new faces. And as we begin, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, we give you thanks for your church. We thank you for the extended family of our local congregations here in the Northwest District. And we thank you for the common ground we have with one another, the most important common ground. That's the blood of Christ, the family bloodline. We thank you that we have received Christ's benefits by faith and have been included in your family, and we can call you Father together. So we ask that you would give us the grace today to rejoice together. We ask that you would bless Pastor Randy as he brings the message, and Brandon as he brings devotional to, and we commit this time to you. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen. Our opening hymn will be number 188, and if you are able, I'll invite you to stand. We'll stand for our opening hymn, number 188.
Thank you.
seated. You can open up to page 2 and we will use the Common Confession of Sin there in your ambassador hymnal. Right there at the beginning of your hymnal, page number 2. If this be the cry of your heart, I invite you to join me in confessing our sin together. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess to you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. Therefore, we plead for refuge to your infinite mercy and ask you, for Christ's sake, grant us forgiveness of all our sins, and by your Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of you and of your will, and true obedience to your word, to the end that by your grace we may come to eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We'll now invite up Brandon Waggy to share a good word from the Bible with us.
When Pastor David asked me to do this devotion tonight, told me that Lyle was supposed to do it and that he wasn't able to because of something that came up for him. And I agreed to doing it, but I figured, well, since I was second string, I figured I'd give a second string devotion tonight. So, but in all seriousness, as that thought crossed my mind, I felt like, how serious is that for us as Christians? How often is Jesus, or how often do we put Jesus as second string? And how ridiculous that is that we would do that. All we have to do is look at the first and greatest commandment. And what does that say? You know, our first and greatest commandment is very clear, and that he wants to be number one in our lives. So if we open to Exodus 20, is where we'll begin reading. So we're going to read Exodus 20, verses 1 through 6. And the Lord says, "And God spoke all these words, 'I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourselves an idol in the form of anything in heaven above, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the fathers to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments.'" And in verse 4, I really like that verse, and it tells us that idols of any form, you know, whether it's money, whether it's for our own good, our fame, our careers, you know, whether it's, I think of myself as a farmer, whether it's tractors, or cows, or whatever, and those are all idols, and we so easily put those in front of Jesus. And if we look back to the first commandment, it says, "You shall have no other gods before me." And then in verse 5, it goes on to say, "You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the fathers to the third and fourth generation." There's very serious consequences for us if we do that. And then we go to Colossians for the second part. It'll be Colossians 3. Colossians 3, verses 1 through 5. "Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things, for you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to you, whatever belongs to your earthly nature, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is all idolatry. And then in verse 1, since they have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above where Christ is seated. We are all held to a higher standard as Christians. And I think that he truly, that we are truly held to higher standards because Christ knows that we have the opportunity and that we've had this place ahead of us. So that's something that we need to remember as Christians. And then verse 2, set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. It just goes back to what I was saying in Exodus, that are the idols of, like I said, fame, careers, whatever it might be. But to keep our minds set on Christ above, on all things above. And then verse 5, we are instructed to put these things to death. In verse 5 it says, put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature. And I think that's a very serious thing that we need to completely put those things aside. And like I said again, there's very serious consequences. Please bow with me. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray this would be a challenge to each one of us tonight, that we would truly put you first in our lives, that money, fame, careers, any other idol that we may have here tonight would take a backseat to our relationships with you. Amen.
Thank you, Brandon, for that good word, putting Jesus first. And as I thought about these devotions, coming up here to the Northwest District on internship in Roseau and then now here in Greenbush, I thought it was a neat thing that the congregations do have at like these meetings and at special meetings, I noticed, too, shared devotionals. And I think it is a very, not just interesting, but important thing, because I was thinking about 1 Corinthians 14:1. It says, pursue love, yet desire earnestly spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. And prophecy is emphasized that not just everybody would have, automatically has that gift, bringing the word of God. And I'm willing to be corrected on this if anyone has comments. Let me know after. Don't correct me now. No. But they were speaking in tongues there. They're exalting that. But Paul says, but if all prophesy, and an unbeliever, an ungifted man enters, he is convicted by all. He is called account to by all. The secrets of his heart are disclosed, and so he will fall on his face and worship God, declaring that God is certainly among you. So that's why I'm encouraged when people come up for devotions, besides them giving the word of God, just the fact they are giving the word of God. So we can even pray for that in our district more and more. Now I invite you to confess your faith along with the rest of the congregation using the words of the Apostles' Creed. And if you need that in front of you, it's on page 4. Of the Ambassador Hymnal. Let's confess our holy faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now I will invite Arlene Jensen to share a special music number.
Good evening. evening.
Good evening.
It's on. Yep.
Yeah.
Oh,
Well, I just want to thank you again for inviting us to be part of this day. This morning, I'm going to spend time with the congregation here in Greenbush. And through this day, your district annual meeting, it's just been a lot of fun. It's sort of just a blessing to be with the body of Christ. And we thank you for that. I promised earlier that I'd share a little bit more about my family. And so there you're going to get to see a quick picture of that's the Nelson clan, most recently. Actually, last Christmas it is, but everybody we got is all there. We have 6 children, 3 daughters-in-law. No, 3 daughters. Yeah, 3 daughters-in-law, right. That's right. And 3 grandchildren, currently. So we're working on that. But we're very thankful. God has blessed us so much. And so we're glad for that blessing. Well, I was asked, obviously we come to talk about this year and the annual theme, or the theme from annual conference, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? From Luke 18, verse 8. And it's an interesting passage. If you take a look at that, you find it actually, it comes at the end of Jesus answering a question about when the kingdom of God would come, in Luke 17. And he describes there in 17, the coming of the kingdom is not something that you will see at first, but there will be signs, including the Son of Man suffering many things. And then there will be events that will signal his return. But it's not going to be the kind of thing where you're going to be able to circle it on your calendar or plan ahead. That it's going to come without warning. And he describes that in Luke 17, first taking a look at verses 28 and on. It says, just as it was in the days of Lot, they were eating and drinking, buying and selling, planting and building. And on the day when Lot went out from Sodom, fire and sulfur rained down from heaven and destroyed them all. So will be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed. And then a little further down, verse 34, I tell you that in the night there will be 2, one in bed, one will be taken, the other left. There will be 2 women grinding together, one will be taken and the other left. And that leads into then Luke 18. And he told them a parable to the effect that they ought to always pray and not lose heart. And he says, in a certain city there was a judge who neither feared God nor respected man. And there was a widow. And there was a widow in that city who kept coming to him and saying, give me justice against my adversary. For a while he refused, but afterwards he said to himself, though I neither fear God nor respect man, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will give her justice so that she will not beat me down by her continuing coming. And the Lord said to her, And the Lord said to her, what the unrighteous judge says, hear what the unrighteous judge says. And will not God give justice to his elect who cry out to him day and night? Will he delay long over them? I tell you, he will give justice to them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? And so I think that context sure helps us understand a little bit what are we getting at? What is he saying? And helps us understand, and you know, just answering that question, what does he mean? What does this phrase mean? When the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? Obviously, we see all the illustrations, right, that he's pointing to that return. But then he tells us, it's pretty plain for us, in verse 1, he says he tells them a parable to the effect that they have to always pray and not lose heart. We have to always pray and not lose heart. As we look at all these various things that he describes are going to come, regardless of those circumstances, the answer is still the same. We have to always pray and not lose heart. Even with an unrighteous judge who neither fears God or respects man, we ought to pray and not lose heart. And the question remains, will Jesus find faith on the earth when he returns? Will he find those who, in spite of the evil and injustice that they see going on around them and are under, will he find those who believe and trust in him? I think these words speak very plainly to us today, and maybe even to what is yet to come. Will Jesus find faith on the earth? Will he find those faithful? Or will he be like the rest of the world? It reminds me of a story I heard about a dangerous seacoast where shipwrecks often occur. And so the locals built a crew to the life-saving station. The building was just a hut, and there was only one boat, but the few devoted members kept a constant watch over the sea, and with no thought for themselves, went out day and night, tirelessly searching for the lost. Some of those who were saved and various others in the surrounding area wanted to become associated with that station and give up their time and money and effort to support that work. New boats were bought, and new crews were trained, and the little life-saving station grew. Some members of the life-saving station weren't happy, though, that the building was so crude and poorly equipped. They felt like that a more comfortable place should be provided as the first refuge for those saved from the sea, and so they replaced those emergency cots with beds and put better furniture in the large building. It wasn't long, and the life-saving station became a popular gathering place for members. They decorated it beautifully, furnished it exquisitely, because they used it as a sort of club. But it wasn't long when they began to notice that fewer members were interested in going out on life-saving missions. So they hired lifeboat crews to go do that work. The life-saving motif still prevailed, though, in this club's decorations, even a miniature lifeboat in the room where club initiations were held. A short time later, a large ship was wrecked off the coast, and the hired crews brought in boatloads of cold, wet, and half-drowned people. They were dirty and sick, and some of them had black skin and yellow skin. The beautiful new club was in chaos. So the property committee immediately had a shower house built outside the club where victims of shipwrecks could be cleaned up before they would come in. At the next meeting, however, there was a split in the club membership. Most of the members wanted to stop this life-saving activity since they were unpleasant and a hindrance to the normal social life of the club. Some members insisted, though, that life-saving was their primary purpose and pointed out that they were still called a life-saving station. But they were ultimately voted down and told that they wanted to save the lives of all the various kinds of people who were shipwrecked in those waters, they could go start their own life-saving station down the coast. And so they did. As the years went by, the new station experienced the same changes that had occurred in the old. It evolved into a club. And yet another life-saving station was founded. Over the years, history repeated itself. And if you visit that seacoast today, you'll find a number of exclusive clubs along the shore. Shipwrecks are still frequent in those waters. But today, most of the people drown. Will Jesus find faith on the earth when he returns? I wonder, are there any rescue stations left? You know, one of the unique things about me that I'm sure most of you certainly wouldn't guess is my experience in the fire service. I'm curious, any volunteer firefighters, EMTs, anybody here tonight? Or maybe you know some of those. I know in rural communities that's a real need. A lot of folks wear multiple hats. When we moved to the congregation in Lisbon in 2000 to serve Lisbon Bethlehem, the parsonage was right next to the fire station. We had a real small congregation. I was looking for a different way. How can we reach into our community? There was four FLC churches in our zip code, and we were by far the smallest. I wasn't looking to steal sheep. How could we reach new and different people? And as it turns out, it wasn't long, and the chief asked me to join. Since I was living right next door and one of the few people that actually worked in town, he said, just come when the whistle goes off, which was easy enough because it was like right outside our window, and we were waking up anyways. Well, when I got to the end of my first month, it turned out twice I was the only one that hadn't showed up. And I realized I was going to need to get better real fast. I was going to learn how to be even able to do anything. Long story short, I started writing along in a full-time department nearby and eventually ended up working for them for 6 years. Ended up being a fireman for 12, volunteer for 12 years, and an EMT for another department for 4 years. And what I was surprised when I came into this interesting opportunity, that there were a number of biblical principles that I saw at work in the church, in the fire department, that really are meant for churches, but are not often seen. And so this evening, I'd like us just briefly look at three of those principles, primarily through Paul's illustration of us being the body of Christ, found in 1 Corinthians 12. And the first biblical principle being that every member is important. Every member is important. You know, I can remember thinking when I got ready to go to that first meeting, what good is a 36-year-old full-sized pastor really going to be? But you know, when I went to that first meeting, I soon found out that I wasn't the oldest, I wasn't the largest, or had the least amount of previous experience. In fact, most, when they began, had little to none. There were farmers and construction workers, stay-at-home moms, teachers, and even some retired factory workers, as well as myself. But what was important was that they were willing. They were willing to come, willing to serve, willing to respond at a moment's notice. And we had to be committed to coming. Even when it wasn't convenient. Committed, even in the middle of the night. Because every member of the department is valuable, necessary, and important. And if they didn't come, they handicapped the ability of the department. In fact, if they didn't come, they put the lives of the other members at risk. I can remember a number of calls where we got by shorthanded, but it was never ideal. And I can remember times when we couldn't go, when we couldn't respond because we didn't have enough to do what needed to be done, where we would have to call on another department to respond to a call in our district from a greater distance away, increasing the response time and perhaps even putting that person's life at risk, that person who was counting on us, who is now in peril because we couldn't respond as we had promised to. And so the point being is that every member is important. Every member is essential. And when members are missing, the whole body is at risk. And the truth is, that's true in the church as well. Because you, as a believer in Jesus Christ, have been gifted by God, not only with the forgiveness of sins, the promise of eternal life, and God's indwelling Holy Spirit, but he has uniquely gifted you to meet a special need within your body, within your congregation, that no one else can fill. 1 Corinthians 12:12 says, "For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in one spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and all were made to drink of one spirit. For the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot should say, 'Because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body,' that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear..." Unless it's part of the body. Yeah. "And if the ear should say, 'Because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body,' that would not make any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? And if the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each and everyone, as he chose." And so it's important that we each remember that you are a member of the body of Christ, of your congregation, and you are important. A second principle that I saw in place here in the fire department was that every member needs to learn to work together. Now, I've only recently become a grandfather. We have three grandchildren. The oldest is Henry, who's almost four. Lucy's two, and Bethany is one. And, you know, it was such a joy to see each one of those little ones move from being, you know, that little ball of flesh that just kind of lay there and slept all the time, to becoming more aware of who they are and their body, learning to follow you with their eyes, recognizing voices and faces, learning to roll over, to crawl or sit up, learning to vocalize or begin to form words, and then try to talk. And now to the point where my little man Henry, he's almost four, and he is Daddy's little helper. And he can hammer a nail, and he can use a screwdriver, and he can even give his parents advice. We are each formed by God in our mother's womb, gifted with all that we need to live. Ears, eyes, legs, heart, stomach, nose. But when we come out 9 months later, we are far from being able to do much. Far from knowing how to work all the cool tools God's given us. Knowing how to focus our eyes or make our hands move and do what we want to do, or really have any idea about what the world is that we've been born into, let alone talk or walk or feed ourselves or do much more. And so in the fire department, it's kind of the same way. Everyone needs training. Oops. It takes being taught. It takes seeing others do it. It takes doing it yourself without the stress of an emergency, and then with the stress of a real situation. Because it's only then we can be of any help on an accident scene or a fire or an EMS call. And that takes time. It takes commitment. And the same is true in the church as well. Yes, we have Sunday school and confirmation. That's really just the beginning of our spiritual training. There's so much more to learn before we really are much help, before we can fully carry out that call of making disciples. But we're hardly even one ourselves. In the fire departments I was a part of, there were tests that you had to pass before you were allowed to jump on the engine and go on a call. You had to be trained and tested in a variety of skills and areas of knowledge. And you had to be able to describe what was behind every compartment door with it closed and know how to use it before you could respond to a call on that particular vehicle. And all that's necessary. And when it comes to training together, working together, learning skills together, so that in the heat of the moment, when lives depend on it, every member knows what they're to do and how to fulfill the role of what they're called to do and work together in harmony with the other members of the department. And even when you get to the point where you're pretty capable, there is still more to learn, still a need to practice and to work on your skills. And the truth is, this learning, practicing, working together is just as important in the church as it is in the fire department. In fact, I would say it's even more so, since the fire department, what they do is only for this life. But what we are called to do has meaning for eternity. And yet, how often do we see members committed to being trained or spending time in God's Word or attending Bible studies? How often do we see our members asking their pastors to be discipled or prayerfully looking to find younger, less experienced believers to mentor or disciple? If truth be told, in many churches, these ideas would be laughed at. Most members would say, "That's too much. You're asking too much. I don't have time for that." That's what we pay the pastor to do. And then we wonder why our churches are dying, why the younger generation is abandoning the faith, why the church is no longer a positive influence on the world around us, but instead is becoming the disciple of its ways. In fact, if we were to be completely honest, I believe that we would announce that most of our churches have become a little more than social gathering places, a place where we come to feel better about ourselves, come and sing a bit, and get our sins forgiven, hear a positive message, and go on our way, instead of us being the body of Christ, where we are needed, committed to, trained and equipped to share the life-changing work of God's kingdom. Which leads us then to our shared motivational principle. A commitment by every member to saving lives. I think most people would be surprised to find out today that of the 1,115,000 firefighters in the United States in 2018, only 33% were career firefighters. And 67%, or 745,000, twice as many, are volunteers. And that 98% of the geographical United States is covered by volunteer firefighters. Volunteer, as in not paid. In fact, when I was a volunteer, I usually spent between $300 to $500 a year out of my own pocket for equipment and training, etc. So why would anyone want to put their life at risk, commit to training at least weekly, and responding every time you were called, day or night? Because of the need. Because if they didn't, there's no one else. Because lives are at stake. Now, not every call is a life-saving call. Over my experience, I've been on over 2,000, and most were not. But some are. And when you hear the page for an unresponsive, non-breathing person, you know that you have a chance to make the difference. And not every call works out. I've done CPR over 40 times, and several of those we were able to revive, but they later died at the hospital that day. But four times they went on to live normal lives. And I remember every one of them. And that's what makes it worth it. That's what makes it worth getting up in the middle of the night for what we call the 333 call. The 3 a.m. third floor 300 pounder who's weak and dizzy. Because of the need. And that's what motivated our Savior as well. Because we were dead in our sins and trespasses. Destined for an eternity in hell. Ephesians 2 tells us, and you were dead in the trespasses of sin and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. But God, being rich in mercy, because of his great love for with which he has loved us, even when we are dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. God, in his great mercy, because of the great love with which he has loved us, rescued us. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, and whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. And he's taught us what that love is by demonstrating it to us and for us, and equipping us to love in that same way. In 1 John 4:7, it says, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world, so that we might live through him. And this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation or payment for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another." And he can call us to love in the same way, because he has given it to us as well as his most excellent gift. And as we go back to our original text there in 1 Corinthians 12, it's all about spiritual gifts and how we all have these gifts. Gifts that we are supposed to use for the building up of the body. But then as he wraps up chapter 12, he says in verse 31, "But earnestly desire the higher gifts, and I will show you a more excellent way." And he leads into 1 Corinthians 13. "If I speak in the tongues of men and angels, but have not love, I'm a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all that I have, and if I deliver my body to be burned but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It does not insist on its own way. It's not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails." God, friends, God says that this love is the greatest gift. His gift to us, and the greatest evidence that we are his. A selfless love that this world does not understand, but desperately longs for. And what God calls us as his disciples, as his children, to first know and then rest in by faith. But also to live out as he lived it out, as ambassadors of his kingdom, that others might see and come to know this love for themselves. You see, the biggest lesson I learned in the firehouse is that it's not about me. It's about others. The firehouse isn't a country club. It's a staging area for the battle, a place to make ready to respond when we are needed. It's the place where I first heard this simple purpose statement. Okay. I am not here for me. I am here for we. And we are here for them. I am not here for me. I am here for we. And we are here for them. Jesus puts it this way in John 15:12. This is my commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. Greater love is no one than this, that he lays down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. Friends, as we think about this imagery and how it speaks to the church, maybe our church, maybe even us, can I ask you to consider, why are you here? Why are you part of your congregation? What is your perception of what the church is supposed to be? And even to consider, what is your role in your congregation supposed to be? And to consider that perhaps it may be different than you first thought it to be. Would you pray with me, please? Lord God, how thankful we are for your infinite love towards us. And truth be told, a love that we cannot fully grasp. For the love that you have demonstrated by coming and dying and paying the price for our sins. A love that by faith in transforms us from being spiritually dead in our sins to being alive with you. Forgiven sons and daughters, now joint heirs of eternal life in the kingdom of God, but also uniquely gifted with skills and talents, the greatest being your love, and the call to share those gifts as members of this body, of our congregation, to give freely, to learn how to use fully, and to exercise together to build up that body. That it might fulfill its mission of reaching the dying in our community. Lord, we see the mess that this world is in. And we can also see that the wisdom and science of this age cannot fix it. That the philosophies and religions of this world are bankrupt because they're built on man. Our only hope is in you, the living God. Help us then, we pray, to not only place our faith and trust in you, but help us to realize the gifts that you have given and entrusted to each of us. May we recognize the call that we have to grow as your disciples, to study and learn your word, to develop skills, and to share your love for others, and that eyes to see and your burden for those souls who are perishing around us. That our church would be the rescue station you desire it to be. And that our community longs for. To your honor and glory. Amen. Let's continue or close by singing together hymn number 71, Jesus Keep Me Near the Cross.
Jesus, keep me near.
close, I want to thank Pastor Randy for sharing not only the word, but just an update from the AFLC. It's really extended family in many ways. The AFLC, Northwest District, a lot of extended family updates today. And thank you, Anna, for not only playing the hymns, but choosing our hymns for the services. And everybody else involved, special music and bringing the word. So many involved. Now, if you would, I'd invite you to stand if you are able. And we'll pray the Lord's Prayer together. So if you would pray with me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive this benediction from Hebrews 13. Now the God of peace, who brought up from the dead the great shepherd of the sheep through the blood of the eternal covenant, even Jesus our Lord, equip you in every good thing to do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Thank you again for coming.
Thank you for coming.
Yeah. Have I taken? No.